Might be better to fork it in here. Might be better to fork it in here.
Okay. So we're live now. That's perfect. So you can get out over. That's perfect. You know what? Can you get the fork? Let's bring the desk in around this way a little. Pull those up. We'll bring those up. I want to park the desk in an angle right here. Okay, so we're live. Can they see Tara?
Uh-huh.
You have to get a little closer.
Hold on.
We're still building an audience, but so just give me just a minute. But this thing hopefully will only be about 15-20 minutes, but
we'll go through it.
And we're trying, we're actually prototyping. This is a prototype live stream 360 rig. Where'd it come from? Miami? From Miami.
Yeah.
So if it starts raining, we're gonna have to get an umbrella, right? Where is the umbrella anyway? Do we have it? We had some Wi-Fi problems. We had to move the camera. We're just rearranging, but obviously the first step, most important thing is just mobilization. So making sure, you know, that everything is set up. Everything's, you know, like as you can see, our ducks are tied, ready to go. And we've got all of our wire and cord. We keep bundled up, clean, because sometimes you get into, you know, jobs where we got to make sure all the cord's clean. And then everything's got cam locks. Now, Terry, you can follow me. As you can see, we have bigger forklifts. Like we've got this lift here, 12,000 pound Tele-Hit or Sunbelt. You know, but you're gonna, but the load center on the desiccants, this one's on a trailer, so it's a little easier to move around, but the desiccants on skids, like the ones behind me, you can see the load center is further out, so it's important that you have something like a telehandler or a, you know, 9,000 pound forklift to safely move it. And safety is also key. Whenever we're setting this, we're dealing with a lot of high voltage power, so it's important we've got glasses, wearing gloves, hard hat, vest. Make sure you know where all our guys are at. So we're just gonna rearrange this thing and then we'll get started on the hookup and the generator. And it's also important when you're setting up, like when you pull into the job, sometimes, you know, sometimes there's a crowd like we have now where it's real time and it's important to clear guys out, you know? Especially when we've got the telehandler and we're working with the heavier equipment, we want to make sure that everything's clear. And most of the time I actually do put a guy full-time, you know, we have a guy set up on just making sure to keep the crowds back, the sidewalks clear. Tristan, join in. How many beers do we have, Tara?
One.
I have a couple on ours.
Now, Tony, is anyone commenting trying to get the live link? We're just moving one unit because we had some technical difficulties with our Wi-Fi speed. And once we're done with that, probably about 3 minutes, we're gonna hook everything up, get everything fired up. Start this way. First thing I'm gonna go through is anyone asking any questions? feel free to question on any of the links. We've got plenty of people searching, looking for your questions. If you missed the live feed, just question, and I'll get back to you hopefully within a few hours. I'll respond via YouTube or Facebook. Now to start, obviously we dispatch the equipment. Now there's equipment vendors in your area. There's the guys like, Bill Leo, there's guys, even you can go to the bigger guys, Sunbelt, United Rental, Herc Rentals. So first step, I would source the equipment. The power is generally very easy to get from any local equipment yard. The desiccants, that's another thing. You want to do a lot of pre-planning of, hey, who's got the desiccants? It may be a competitor, it may be Sunbelt, but for example, Sunbelt here in the Bay Area, they only have, most of the time they have 1 5,000 CFM sitting in the yard. So if you need more than one, you need to have a backup plan. We have a lot of competitors that call us to rent our desiccants locally. And there's private guys that may own 40 of these things scattered across the country. So it's important that you make those connections before you get the large lots, okay? Now the setup, don't be afraid of it. First job I ever did, I was 20 years old. We set four of these 5,000s and dried out a 300,000 foot flood, okay? Let's get Tyler and Hammer, let's get these cords out and we'll get those ready to plug in. Tristan and I have been working together a long time, right? You have everything to say on just not being intimidated by the power and the size of the equipment?
It's like a large loss. The equipment's just, it's pretty much the same equipment that we use on any size flood, whether it's residential or anything, in terms of kind of how it works and what the purpose of the equipment is. It's just a larger piece of equipment. So in terms of being intimidated, I wouldn't really be intimidated. Obviously when you've got semi-trucks rolling in, everybody gets intimidated when you see a semi-truck with equipment coming into the job. But in terms of hooking it all up and how it all works, we'll go through that with you guys and show you. And you'll see in detail here how these things go, and hopefully you're comfortable with it as well. And if not, then feel free to ask questions.
And the training, I know Jim Thompson does a lot of training with Sunbelt where you can go do the live training. The goal of this is really, if you're renting the equipment, this video is going to give you a better understanding of how it should get hooked up. Some things to look for, that way you're not dependent on, a technician that's out there that maybe he doesn't know a whole lot about these units. The other thing I would say is knowing this ahead of time and going through this tutorial before you have the loss is important, because as we all know, these things don't come Monday morning at 8 a.m. Typically, we're setting a desiccant, Christmas Eve, 4 p.m. in the afternoon. So it's important that we know and that everyone's working as a well-oiled machine. So first step, we've got our power. Now for a 5,000 CFM desiccant, we can run it off of we've got a 125 kilowatt generator, and there's people think there's different sizes you should use. I think you should match it with anywhere from like a 125 to a 200 kilowatt generator, okay? This is a 175 Caterpillar. So first step, I typically make sure the unit starts. We'll make sure it started on. I don't know if we started today. So first step, you can come over here, Tara. On all these units, there's a battery on and off. So right now it's on, but we switch the key, make sure that it's on. That's gonna get power to all your systems. Anytime we're working inside of the unit, you wanna make sure it's off and safed out, okay? Now that we're on, now we come to the back of the unit and we turn it on. We want to make sure that the breaker right here, we've got on and off. Make sure the main breaker's off, okay, obviously. So for this, we're going to put it to a run mode because we're going to run it 24/7. So now we're up and running. It's important, let's see, big thing with generator, making sure your fueling set up. So in the Bay Area, like we call, who do we call?
Pacific States
fueling. That way we don't have to handle the fueling. We've got transfer tanks that at least to get us through the first night, you know, 100 to 200 gallon tanks. But you will burn a full tank of fuel, depending on the size of the auxiliary, you're gonna burn a full tank every 12, 24 hours. So make sure that your fueling set up, okay? I like to warm the unit up, make sure this system's working, okay? Once it's warmed up, pretend it's warm, we shut it down, and we're gonna connect all of our cam locks, okay? This is a big deal, making sure that you've got your colors matched. Let's connect these up, guys. So prior to, you wanna make sure, well, if you own the unit, that all your colors match so you're not on the job, you know, putting the wrong phasing to the wrong cam lock. Now you can zoom in a little on one of these. As you can see, so this would be a female and your film the end. This is your female, this would be a male end, and it's just a twist lock, okay? So, you can see Tyler, we press him in. Now for the speed of the video, we're trying to get this done, but there's a little notch on the inside, and that lines up with, there's a little void on the male, okay?
Does it matter which one you put in first, this one or this one?
Put them all in at the same time. Big thing that matters is just making sure all your breakers are off, okay, and that the unit's off. And then once it's in, now you have to twist it, so twist it tight. A couple of these are a little loose. Now anyone that works with power every day, this is like second nature, but if you don't work with this equipment, it's, you know, like an example is a guy plugging it in and then maybe he doesn't twist it, or he doesn't twist it tight enough, you know, or he's trying to put the female to female. So it's important that these are all set. Also, now anytime you have the wire, the cam should be tight, but if it's loose where the cord wants to pull out, then you've got to take apart the cam and make sure that everything's tight, all your connections are tight. Okay, so now we're all set. We're gonna flip the unit on. To run. Now, one other side thing on all generators, the big red button is the emergency shutoff that you don't want to. We get an umbrella, guys. Tyler's on the umbrella. So the emergency shutoff. This is not how you shut the unit off. It'll literally seize the unit. So you want to make sure you turn it on and off with this on and off button. And that's a rookie thing. A guy will go up and hit that button, and you can damage the unit. So we're gonna fire it up. Thanks, guys, for connecting the cord. How's the audio, kid? Where's the flathead screwdriver?
I got to pull all the cover top of that skin.
Now, typically, part of the tutorial, I added the radio, something cool, but once you get, you know, you may have your desiccant tubes running inside the building, and you need to be able to communicate between the guy starting the desiccant and the guy in the building, especially if you've got lay flat, you know. Lay flat starts blowing all over, you may need to get the quick word to turn it off, so that's why we go radios, okay? Now next step, well, we skipped one. Where's that flathead at? Gotta shut this off. So another big step, skipped over, but I usually check, and don't be intimidated by the panel. All these panels are about the same, at least on a CDI unit. Do we have any ballers yet?
Six.
So if you can see, zoom into this panel. Now we double check, we make sure that all systems are off before we open the panel. But right here, sometimes these breakers will go out, so we just want to make sure that they're all on, okay, everything is good, and also the contactors. When you press them in, now they come back out, so you know all your contactors are good. Now this is a newer machine, so we don't have as many issues, but the older machines, your contactors go out a lot, You know, these breakers can go out. That's why we have spares. And if you own some of these machines, don't get caught without spare parts. These are the most important parts, okay? You can call Tom at CDI, he can ship you the parts. Here, guys, we're done with parts. So now we know all our breakers are on, we're all good. So we're gonna shut it up. You wanna pull this other camera? We got a few different live streams going right now. So we're gonna shut this up because we don't want it open. You don't want guys reaching in there when the thing's powered. Electrical hazard. Okay, and I triple check all the cams, especially because guys, remember, like right now the rain's throwing us off, and it's a great example of you're never setting a desiccant when it's sunny and it's Monday morning. This has happened when it's storming, it's raining, it's freezing, snowing, and it's late at night, and you can easily make mistakes, okay? And you don't want to make mistakes that are going to cause the site to be unsafe. So we triple check, okay, all of our cams are tight. I'm going to triple check these. Let's check this site out. We triple check all our cams are tight. Ultimately, there's to be one guy responsible for firing everything. So we're going to fire it back up. As Jim Thompson says, we're good. A couple of the feeds can come. We're gonna pull all the covers off.
What does Jim Thompson say?
So Jim Thompson's famous. He says you gotta let the generator make love with the unit for a few minutes before you fire everything up. get all your systems powered up. Okay. You can pull the live feeds. Now we're pulling the covers. You see the covers on the front? Can you see the front of the backside? So the covers. You see we're pulling all these covers off. Okay, our intakes. And then there's two covers for the wheels that run air over the wheels. Let's look at the front and the back. This one, there is a cover where we can duct it, but there's also a flap on this particular unit. We just pin the flap up. Okay, so we're all good to go. Now we're on the job site. We're also going to level it. So next step, how's our 360 feet? Is it working? Is it up? Sorry, our video is back up. And I'll cut that piece out for the guys that are recording. Okay, guys, is it good now? sideways in your feet. Once you check, you're in this. Okay, so we're going to continue with the tutorial. Tara, watch. So now we're going to... Where were we? We've got all of our covers up. We've gone through our breakers. We've got our cams connected. Now we're going to flip the breaker to on. Okay, so now we're giving power to the unit. Now, we're going to go to the unit, and we're going to switch the main to on. You may have to get closer so they can hear me. So we're going to switch the supply to on. 460 volts. Now, for the purpose of this training, I'm going to open this. We're gonna adjust the voltmeter on this thing. So right now, this voltmeter is at 466. So what we're gonna do is pan over to Tristan. Tristan's gonna turn it up. He's gonna turn the voltage adjuster up and get it real close to her. So they can read away. So that's the voltage. That's the voltage adjuster. Yeah, so they can read the sign on it. Okay, so he's gonna turn that up. Now back up to me. And then he's gonna match it, so like right now we're at 480, but I think they like anywhere from like 470, 480, we usually set them. Now do not try that at home. You can actually see through the glass, you can see up and see what that meter is. Now, so we're on, and then here we're gonna go from continuous to auto, from off to continuous. And there's an auto mode that, for the purpose of an emergency restoration job, we just wanna flip to continuous. Okay, and now we're gonna give the unit about 20 seconds, let it start up. And actually film this, Tara. There's, on all these units, there's startup procedures here. Okay, and there's troubleshooting procedures. So if you look at the unit close enough, you can find all these procedures. So now we're up and running. We like to let it run before we put the ducts on. We get it up, fired up, let it run, let it burn out a little. Get all of our doors closed up, safed off. Okay. Now the tricky part, once we have our ducts ran into the building, if you've got lay flat, you may have to do a combination of turning it on, turning it off, get the lay flat full of air, or you're gonna just blow the lay flat right off the end of the ducts, the hard ducts. Okay. Now, this thing registering yet? Right here, check out the control panel. So we're not getting the react rate yet, but right here, I don't know if you can see on the video, but there's lights, power on, call for dehumidification, react fans on, react airflows on. If there's an issue, typically it's going to give you like a other faults light, and then you just gotta have to troubleshoot. And typically, like I said, the troubleshooting has to do with a switch being out, or a contactor's bad. What else? What else goes wrong with these?
If you don't have the caps off the ends, then the unit will shut down automatically.
Right.
On some of the bigger units we have, like 15,000 CFM inside, I can't remember if these ones have it, but they have flap adjusters on the inside. If one of those flap adjusters, one of the rods comes undone or something like that, and the unit can't push air through it, then it'll automatically go into a safe off mode and turn itself off.
Are we still live on a 360?
Wi-Fi was down.
Okay, so we lost all of our 360 viewers. I hope they know to join us here on Facebook Live. So now we've got kicked in where we're getting the react rate. We're actually pulling humidity out of the air. You can see the bars right there. You can see the red bars. So that's telling us, you know, the unit, everything's running good. We're not, we don't have any other fault light codes. So now, and actually, yeah, you just heard as the unit kicks in, you can hear the generator really starts kicking in. You can hear it powering, you know, spooling up. Okay. So we're gonna shut everything down now, just for the purpose of the end of this training video. I'm gonna shut everything down and we'll go through the shutdown procedures. Now, the proper way to shut it down is you come to here, and first step, the supply fan switch, turn it to off. Now the unit's not gonna shut off immediately because it needs to go through a cool down period. So there's heat banks in there. If you just go shut the dead man switch off, you can damage the unit because the heat banks don't get a chance to cool down. So right now the unit's still on, it's in a cooling mode, it's cooling. Are we back live on the 360? Okay, we're offline, but we're gonna get the 360 back up to you. So now we've got our heat banks. They're still cooling down. Usually they take a few minutes to cool down, especially after a big job, they take several minutes. So we'll let those cool. And then when they're done cooling, I'm gonna do a quick, just show you how we set the ducts up, the difference between the hard ducting and how we pump it through a door. So some preset plywood you can cut out, and we'll be done with the tutorial. How many minutes we have? So we're still cooling. Turn around the back. So you'll hear the unit shut down, but right now it's still blowing here. We know it's still cooling. So we'll give it just a minute. That's the other thing I'd like to speak to you, just the patience. Make sure you're patient with it because you've got high voltage, you know. I want to make sure that we're doing everything safe. If you start the stream with the phone in landscape mode, that'd be good. So now we're shut down. Second step, turn off the main. So now all the power is off of this unit. Power is still in our lines. Okay, next step. We're gonna shut the main breaker on the unit off right here. Now the lines are de-energized, power's off. Okay, and then lastly, we'll shut the generator down. Can we pan over to the backside? Guys, let's get the duct work out. Let's just get them untied. And then I'm gonna talk about the spirals on them. Now on this particular unit, fueling, you guys can come around the side. This particular unit, you know, we fuel it from the interior. Okay, we're fueling it right here. We've had lots of guys, hey, where's the fuel cap or where's the filler? Okay, the filler's on the interior. A lot of the generators, the filler's on the tongue. You've got a secondary and then the actual unit. So you'll have two fillers. Okay, this unit I think takes, maybe it's got like a 300 gallon tank. Fuel is a big deal because if you run out of fuel, you're not going to look very good on the job. So right now what we're going to do is we're going to come back over here. We'll talk about ducting. And so this would be an intake duct. And we've got, I think this is what, 2-inch spiral, or on a 3-inch. So the spirals on the intake duct are tighter. So there's, you know, as you guys know, there's steel in here and they're tighter. So they'll call this is a 20-inch duct And then the spiral is on a 3-inch. So that's the spacing between the spirals. That's what prevents it from collapsing. Okay, so this we'd use the intake duct. It's actually a lot heavier, so. Anytime we're using supply, we like to use the lighter stuff, and this is more on a 6-inch. So with the bigger span, but as a supply, we don't need that support that we need on the suction line. And the 6-inch, really all it does, it just makes the duct a lot lighter, and I think it's a little cheaper too. These are 25-foot ducts. We order them in 25-footers just for ease of handling and moving them around, okay? So let's hook these up. You guys wanna hook each one up? Now some of the older units, I'm gonna show you, let me pan around the backside now. We have to move the 360 rig. Actually, you know what? Let's move this thing right back. Okay, let me move this so we can get this going. This is the outlet. So on each unit, it's going to say your outlet and inlet. So this is the outlet, your supply. These units, it's very nice. They've got these easy cams. You know, we just screw them down. The older units, you're going to need, like, we've got a Desiccant box where we've got all of our parts, all the spare parts, breakers, zip ties. But you're going to need, on the older units, to screw in sheet metal screws, and then that's what will secure your ducts. Oh man, now we're all muddy here, huh? So you guys get the point. This would be your intake. Okay, where's that screwdriver? Tristan. So this would be your intake. And where are the blue ducts? Now I'm gonna open it up. We'll go through a little filter demonstration and then we'll be done. Is Tristan there? Okay. Where do you go?
I just paused this one so I'm gonna make another one.
Someone have a set of car keys? Here, you want to open this up?
We got guys. Well, how many followers we got right now?
Tara? One?
They are coming and going. There's been 146 views.
Let's open up both these doors. So, now the filter is a little different on each unit. On this unit, we'll show you right here. You guys open this door up? Well, while he's opening that, we'll show you the wheel. So in here's the wheel, you can get a good idea what that looks like. And that's all that is Desiccant silica, and as the air runs through, it's stripping all the moisture out of the air and it's putting, you know, air into the building at 1 or 2% humidity. Now this unit's a little dirty, but we like to make sure that everything's clean on the inside. Now, I know for you guys renting it, you really don't care, but if you own the unit, make sure that this compartment's clean, you know? We don't want things getting into the impeller on the other side or we can damage the unit. Now, filters, pretty simple. This unit's got three filters. Just like most of the dehus you guys are used to, they just slide right in, okay? This is a 20 by 25, standard from Abadix. It's important you put fresh filters on though, you know? Air quality. Any other questions? Is anyone on there? Did anyone ask questions? Where's Tony at?
Did
anyone ask questions?
One of the big things to look out for on these jobs is when you run your intake duct out, you got to make sure that there's no papers or anything like that in the building that can get sucked into that duct, because what will happen is they'll come up and they'll block this, and if they block this screen right here, then the unit will shut off. So you got to make sure that this is clear and that wherever your duct is sucking from, that it's clear of sucking any papers from an office building or
hard
anything
hats
like that.
We had a guy literally he was sitting within 3 feet of the intake, sucked the hard hat off of his head. And we should show you right now. Tyler, let's get this board and then let's get the intake. So the access, I know everyone's seen pictures and we can get more on it, but bring that board over. Each building's a little different, but typically this is the idea. We board up a door, window, throw the intake in on one side. I like to do it on top all the time because of what Tristan's saying. There's so much suction pressure that it's gonna wanna suck down onto the floor, or it's gonna wanna suck things into it. So I like to just try and tie it up right on top there. Another way that we'll do it, typically we tie ropes and we'll actually tie the duct off to a pole, post, desk, something to keep that pressure, because the intake's gonna wanna suck in on itself. And then the supply, we would run the supply. 360 still recording. So our supply would run through the bottom. If it's one big open atrium type space, we would just run it dumped just like this. If you've got several floors or rooms, then what we'll do is we'll attach lay flat to that. Which we could do a mini seminar on the distribution, but any questions? I think that pretty much explains it, and every single one of you guys watching now or in the future should be able to set up a Desiccant. If you have any questions setting up a Desiccant, you call me, I'm literally a flight away, okay? If you have any questions about who to rent from or preset pricing, then you call me, I'm literally a cell phone call away, okay? If you want to know more about our group and how I mobilize Desiccants all over the world, which is true, we have guys in Australia, Canada, I got a guy in the UK, I think we even just got a guy down in Key West to sign up. Then please join my private group. In the private group, we get more into the pricing, price lists, how to get paid, how to get the bigger jobs that are going to require Desiccants. In your market, there's Desiccant jobs happening at least once a week nonstop, okay? And you may not think that, but it's happening. And I want to get you on more of these jobs. That's why you need to join my group, okay? Now, if you don't want to join my group, or maybe you're a client and you just find it interesting, then just follow our page and also follow our YouTube. We're gonna do a lot coming up. Any questions? Close it. No one has any questions on e-feeds? I hope all the feeds are working. We have two or three live feeds, and we have one YouTube 360 feed, which is actually a prototype. And what we're gonna do is we'll cut it together for one video. I'll try and cut it so it's one, fast video, and I'll load that within a couple weeks.
After, too, we can answer questions.
Okay, good idea. If you have questions, then we'll answer questions later. Thanks for tuning in.